Welcome back, friend. So now what we are going to do is, let's create a branch called as validate add user form branch. And in this branch, we are going to start coding for the add user form validation. So let me create a branch first. So we will call this branch called as validate add user form. And this branch, I will clone it from my starter kit. Once this branch is created, I can publish this branch from here. And why I'm creating this branch, so that you can follow along with me. If you missed typing along with me currently, then don't worry, just watch it carefully, and then you can always go to the code base and search for this branch and just start coding from there. So in this branch, what I will show you first is, this is my page where I have a form and I have a table. So let me run this code first to see whether I am able to see my HTML or not. So I would say npm run serve in order to run this code, and I can see my page coming up here. In this case, what we will do is, our goal is to start validating the full name and then email ID. You can see right now validation is not working completely. So let me first create a folder under the app. So we are going to write the code under the client folder, and in the client folder, we will go first into the app folder, and here we will create all of our components inside this app folder. So let me first create a folder called as validate add user form. So this will be our folder where we will be writing all of our functions which will be responsible to do the validation for the form. As per our discussion we went through, the first function we will write is publish add user form updated. So publish add user form updated is a function who will read the data from the DOM and it will publish a message. So let's start writing this code. So we will create a file called as publish add user form updated.js. So in this JavaScript file, our goal is to create a function who will read the DOM value and publish a message. So let's write a function first, and the function name we can call it publish validate user form. Like I said, this function will be basically listening to the DOM changes. So what I will use over here is jQuery delegate. So I told you initially that you have to learn little bit of jQuery in order to follow along this code. So let me show you what exactly jQuery delegate is quickly. So you can see here, you have a table, and if you click me here, it will say another paragraph. So you have a body. Inside the body, I have a paragraph which is called as click me. And in this paragraph, if I'm clicking, then it is showing some message to us. It is basically appending another paragraph inside the body, right? So this click event should happen whenever I click the paragraph, not the body, right? So if I click this paragraph, then only this should happen, correct? This should append the thing. However, if you notice the code here, we are not writing anything, any click event on the paragraph. We are writing the click event on the body itself. So what jQuery will do is, it will put the event on the body. However, it will keep eye that from which element this kind of event is bubbling up, right? That is function called as delegate. So delegate is the API which will check that from which element this event is bubbling up. If this event is bubbling up from a paragraph, then what kind of event it is? Is it a click event? Okay, then only it will execute your function. So that is delegate. Delegate means you just write a event handler on the top label element, and in the API you pass, okay, which element you are interested on and what kind of event you are interested on, and then just write your function that you want to execute. So this way you write your code on the higher level element and you don't worry about the smaller elements, right? So I just like delegate, therefore I am going to use delegate here. So I will put the delegate in my form, and then I will check if any of the event is coming from the input element, and the event name will be also input. Means whenever something is getting input over here, then I want to execute my function. So let's use the delegate now. So if I go here, I will wait when DOM is ready, and whenever DOM is ready, then I am going to bind the event. So we will see our form. If you go to the form, we have a form and whose ID is user form. So I will use user form ID, and I will bind this with the delegate function. So in the delegate function, you have to supply the selector. So I will use input as a selector. Input means any element whose tag name is input, I want to watch their event. So I have two input, one is email and name. And what kind of event I want to watch? So I will say input event I want to watch, and I want to execute a function call. So basically I can rename this function. So we can call it publish add user form updated message. So this is the function that we are going to call. As I already explained, this function will read the data from the DOM and it will publish an object in the message format. So let's create the full name, which will read from the name property of the DOM. Next, we will read the email, which we will read from the email input. And let me put the hash over here. After that, once this full name and email is there, we need to construct an object that our program will understand, right? So this function is an abstraction over the DOM. That means it will read the DOM data. But this DOM data, like email and full name, it could be many property, right, in the user object. So all of these properties, you cannot just send them as a one by one. You have to create a single conceptual object out of it. So let's create a user object first, which we will create it as a constructor, and then we will pass these values in there, and then we will publish the user object. So let me go into the app folder and I will create a model folder over here. Inside the model folder, let's create a user.js file. In the user.js file, we are going to create a class called as user, which will have a name and email. So let me create a constructor first. Inside the constructor, I'm allowing client to pass name and email, and then it will construct it. So it will say this dot name is equal to name and this dot email is equal to email. So this way it will create a user object. This is a class, right? And you might be wondering how I am using a class in JavaScript. But don't worry, I am using the ES6 feature and I am using a Webpack to compile this project. So therefore, all of the ES6 features you can use here, feel free to use that. And Webpack will compile it, right? So let's begin. So one important thing to note here. So whenever you have a class and you are going to create an object out of it, make sure you create the unique identity for that object so that you can track that object. You can save that object, you can delete that object. Therefore, it is a good idea to always create an ID of an object. So since this is my demo project, what I will do is I will use a date time to create a unique ID. But in your production application, you might be using some of the complicated and sophisticated way to create a unique ID. So let me do this dot ID, which is equal to date dot now to string. So this way I make sure that I create a unique ID every time my user object is created. Now we will go back to publish add user form updated message function. And here it is a good time now to create a user object. So we will say constant user is equal to new user, and I will pass full name and the email. Next, it is the time to publish this message into our project. So once we publish this message, then all of our components can listen it out, right? So let's publish a new message. In order to publish and subscribe, I'm using jQuery Tiny PubSub plugin. So this is the jQuery Tiny PubSub plugin. Basically, it will allow you to subscribe and publish a message. You can publish a topic. Topic is the unique ID or unique name that you can publish it, right? And then you can pass the payload, some values. Similarly, you can subscribe on a topic and then react onto it, right? So say suppose you are publishing 1-2 on a topic called as foo, and you have already subscribed on foo, then this create logger function will be called and the data will be passed over here. So if you have noticed our project, then you will see that we have already included tiny PubSub CDN URL in our script path, right? So let's go back to publish add user form, and then we will start publishing a message from here. So we will say $.publish, and then here I am going to write a message called as add user form updated. And then we will pass the user object. So this function, we are going to listen the DOM, and whenever this DOM is changing, we are going to publish this message, right? So the moment you are changing, you are publishing a message. So let me put the export over here so that we will have a module ready, and this component is done. With this component, we read the DOM value and we published a message, right? So we have just finished published add user form updated component. So the next thing I want to write is create a add user form validator. So this is a function where I am going to write the validation logic. So we will create a new file. We will call it validate add user form. And in this file validate add user form, I am going to add a function. So let's create a function called as validate add user form. Add user form. And this function will be basically called whenever the add user form updated message will come. So therefore, let's subscribe to the add user form updated message. And then we will call validate add user form function. Right. So here you can see whenever this message will happen, add user form updated, this function will be called, right? Validate add user form. And here I am going to do some validation and then return true, false, whatever, right? So you can see here add user form updated. This is a string that I am duplicating basically. So if you see first time I published here and I use the same string, and here I am going to subscribe and I'm going to use the same string. Suppose this message you want to subscribe in more files, then you will be keep repeating this string continuously, right? So if you repeat some string, then there is a chance that you may do some mistake on it. Therefore, what I will do is I will avoid repeating things. I will keep it simple and keep it dry. Dry means do not repeat yourself. So we will not repeat this thing, and we will go into the model folder and create a new file called as messages. And in this file, I will go and put all of the messages that I wanted to create, right? So you can see I have put three messages. One is add user form updated, add user form valid, and add user form invalid. This is the messages.js file where we will keep adding our messages as we go further. So now we will go back to the published add user form updated. And here, instead of writing the string, I will now use the add user form updated message from the messages object. So similarly, I will go back to the subscriber here and remove the string, and I will use add user form updated. So we will validate the name first, name result, which will be coming from is name valid, and we will pass. So this function will receive two properties. One is topic, which is the message object message, and then another is the payload, which is the user. So since message is the topic and user is the payload, we will receive the user object from this message. And we will say take the user dot name and validate it. So this function we are going to create soon. Next we will validate the email. So we will say email result, which is nothing but is email valid, and we will pass user dot email. So these are the two validation functions that we are going to create soon. Once these validation functions are created and we have got these results, our job is to check if both results are correct or not. So we will check if name result is true and email result is also true. So in this situation, I want to just stop execution and just publish a message saying that add user form is valid. So I can say return, and then I'll say dot publish add user form is valid. And then you can also pass the second parameter, the user object. This is the happy path, means the path where somebody has entered the correct name and email ID, right? So next is our error course. A happy path can be also called as main course. And the next one is the error course. So in the error course, what we are going to do is we will check if the email or name anybody is wrong, just publish the message invalid and pass the actual message that we want to show into the UI. Next, let's write a function to validate name and email ID. So first I will write a function called as isNameValid, and we will get a name over here. So remember we said the rule are like name should not be empty and it should be minimum 4 character. So let me write that function over here to do that validation. So we'll say if name is, so I will trim the name before in order to validate. I will say if name is not empty, and we should also check name is not null, and name is not empty. And we should also check if the length of the name is greater than 4. These are our business rules. So here we will have to check that if name is not null, and we will check if name is not empty and the length of the name is greater than 4. Then basically we are going to return true. Otherwise we will return an string where we will have some message. So we can return full name is invalid. Full name is invalid. So next function that we are going to write is email valid. We will get an email ID and then we have to check whether this email is valid or not. Here I can use some regular expression to the email validation, but I don't want to make it so complex. So therefore just I will keep it simple. I will again check if it is not null, not empty, and it has the @ and dot symbol. So let's do those check. So I can copy this much here from here, and we will make sure we replace the name into email. And we will check if email is not null and email is not empty string. And then we will also check that email has @ symbol and email has dot symbol. So this way we will confirm that this email has @ and dot symbol. And in order to check the index of @ and dot, you should always check if it should be greater than -1. So that way you will check if email index of dot is greater than -1, that means you will say that email has dot symbol in it. So if all of these conditions are satisfying, then only we will say yes, validation is passing. Otherwise we have to return a string message saying that email is invalid. So just notice over here, we are trying to validate the property, and when it is valid, we are returning true. When it is not valid, we are returning a string with the message. Therefore, in the error course, what I will do here is I will check if it is a string, then publish a @userform invalid message. So here we will see if type of name result is of string type, then basically we want to publish a negative message, which is invalid message. So we'll say invalid. So here I can use @userform invalid, and then I can pass the message which is coming from the function, and this message is the name result variable. So similarly we will check the email, and we will also return the negative message for email. So we'll say email result is of type of string, then we will say @userform is invalid, and we will also pass the email result. So whoever is subscribed to this message, they will receive this kind of payload, right? Okay, so what we will do now is just recap this function carefully, what we did so far, and then we will proceed for the next component. So we are subscribing to a message, and see here this message is missing. Let me fill this blank. So we will say @userform is updated. So this is the message that we are interested on. So we will listen to the @userform updated message, and we will call this function. In this function, we will receive the message and the user payload. What we will do is, and we will check if the name is valid, and we will also check if email is valid. In order to check, we have created a function called as isNameValid function, and we are passing the name, which is user.name from here. And in this isNameValid, you'll get the name, and you'll check if name is not null, and if it is not empty, and if it is greater than 4, then only it is true. Otherwise we will say full name is invalid. Similarly, line number 7, what we are doing is we are checking if email is valid or not, and we have created private function called as email valid. Here I'm getting an email, and I'm checking whether it is not null, it is not empty, it has a dot, and it has @ in it, and then I'm returning a true. Otherwise it is a invalid. Whenever I receive these two variables, I have to check the main course is, the happy path is both should be returning true, and we will be publishing @userform is valid. That's our happy path. In our error course path, we will check if name is invalid or email is invalid. We will publish the form invalid message, and we will send the message what exactly we want to show into the UI. So with this function is complete. If you have any questions or any doubt, feel free to write your messages in the comment box. So next, we are going to write a function called as enable user submit. This is a very simple function. It will listen add user form valid message and it will enable the submit button. So it is the abstraction over the DOM basically. So it is trying to listen a message from the message service, that is one resource, and it is going to update the DOM, which is the another resource. So this function is again following single responsibility principle and it is abstracting out our DOM object. So we will be making sure that we are always dealing with two resources and we are adhering to single responsibility principle. And let's go ahead and write the code for enable user submit. So we are under validate add user form folder and we will create enable user submit.js file. And inside this file, we are going to subscribe to add user form valid message and then we will enable the submit button. So if you see the index.html and notice over here in this button, I have marked this button as disabled, right? So by default, this button is disabled. Therefore, in this function, when we are going to enable the button, we have to remove this attribute from jQuery. So let's do that. So we'll go to the enable user submit and first we will subscribe to the message called as add user form is valid. And whenever this form is valid, I'm going to basically enable the button. Therefore, let's write a function which will be our component and then function name will be enable add user form submit. So we'll call it enable add user form submit. This is my function. So I will create a function called as enable add user form submit. And here we will just write a jQuery to do that. We have to select the submit button and you can check the submit button ID before we write a selector. So go to index.html and check your submit button ID. So my submit button ID is add user. I will select using add user. So I will call it add user and then basically I will say remove attribute. So this remove attr is a function which will remove the attribute from the button. So which attribute I want to remove? I want to remove the disabled attribute. So this way I will enable the button. So this function is very simple. It is just listening to add user form valid and removing the attribute called as disabled. So next component and the final component that we are going to write is called as disable add disable user submit. So disable user submit is the component which will listen to the invalid message, the add user form invalid message, and it will disable the button. So it is again abstraction over DOM. It is listening to the message and whenever this message will arrive, it will disable the button. So technically, if I will tell, it will basically add an attribute called as disable in the submit button. So let's go ahead and create a function for this. So we will call disable user submit .js and here our goal is to listen to invalid message, add user form invalid message and disable the submit button. So we'll say $subscribe to add user form invalid message and then we will call this disable add user form submit function. So this is the function that I'm going to create now, disable add user form submit, export function. And you can notice I am not writing message and payload over here. So although we are receiving message and payload, we are not interested for those data. Therefore, we are not writing it here. So here we will again search the add user and then we will add the new attribute called as disabled. So this way we will disable the submit button, right? With this, we have completed our validation user story and let's see if it is working or not. So what we will do is we will put them in the DOM and we will see validation is working or not. Let's recap what we have done so far. First, we go ahead and created a user class. In user class, we have name, email and ID. Next, I have created a messages object where I have put couple of topics that I wanted to publish. Next, I created a publish add user form. Publish add user form updated component. It's going to listen to the input event in the form and create a user object and publish that user object with a topic called as addUserFormUpdated. Next, we have created a validate addUserForm component. In this function, it will listen to the topic called as addUserFormUpdated and it will get the user object in the subscribe message. Whenever it will receive this topic, then it will validate the name and it will validate the email ID. Any of them property is not correct, then it will publish addUserFormInvalid message with the proper message that in the UI we are going to display. Whenever both name and email ID is correct, it is going to publish addUserFormValid message. Next, we have created enable addUserFormSubmit component. In this component, we are going to listen addUserFormValid topic. Whenever addUserFormValid topic is received, then it is going to enable the button. Next, we have created a disable addUserFormSubmit component. In this function, we are going to listen to the topic called as addUserFormInvalid, and whenever we will receive this topic, we are going to disable the button. If you have noticed, in my original website, if I write a wrong full name, then I am also displaying a invalid message in the UI. So far we have not coded for this. Let me first show you how enable and disable button is working like we have coded yet. Once that enable and disable button will be working, next we will work on displaying the message as well. So now we have created this component, it's time to create the barrel out of each module and put those barrels in the main index JavaScript file. What is barrel and how to create a barrel? For that, I will recommend you to read my article that I have already wrote. Go to the Google and type barrel Rupesh Tiwari and you will get the first article which is that I have written. So if you click that create barrel for TypeScript project, never mind, even though it is a TypeScript project, it is still valid for this project also. So here I have mentioned what is a barrel. So basically, if you have a three files, apple, banana and oranges, you have to import all of these three files independently wherever you want them. However, if you create a barrel or if you just create a one index.js file within that module, within the fruits module, then in order to import all of them or in order to import any of them, you don't need to put the file names independently. You can just say fruits, import fruits, and then it will import everything together. For example, here, how to create a barrel. And if you see, I have created an index.js file, and in that index.js file, I have already exported all of the three fruits. So here you see index.ts file is created within the fruits folder. Within the index.ts file, we have exported them, exported banana, exported apple, export oranges. Therefore, what will happen is whenever I need a fruit, any fruit, either orange, banana or whatever, I can just import them from ./fruits only. So this way you save little space and you don't need to keep typing every time each and every file name. You don't need to know their file names. That is the benefit basically. So from the outer world, you don't need to say I have to bring oranges from oranges file. You just say I have to bring oranges from the fruits module. So similarly, rxjx, whenever you want to get any operator, let's say filter operator, do you say rxjs/operator/filter? No, you say import from rxjs/operators. That's it. So in rxjx also, they have created the operators as a barrel and they have put all of the operators in that barrel itself. Therefore, it is easy for the end client to import any operator they wish to import. And they don't need to know the internal file structure for them. So we will also do the same thing. We will go ahead and create a single barrel file inside validate addUserForm. So that from the root index file, I have to just say export star from validate addUserForm. So currently I am doing that, but however, I have not created a barrel file inside the validate addUserForm. It will not work. Let me create a index.js here. And inside the index.js, we will go ahead and export all of our files. So we'll say export star from, first file is disabled, user submit. And next file is enable user submit. After that, we will export publish add user form. Update it. And next, we will export from validate add user form. So this way I have created a single barrel file for this module called as validate add user form. I can go ahead and just export the entire module from here, and it will export all of the files for us. Next, we will also create a barrel file for our model module. So we will treat the entire folder as a single module. So now we will create a index.js under the model module, and then I will export my messages module. I will also export user module. So this way I have created a single module called as model. And now in the index, we can export the model also. So I can go ahead and say export star from model. So far we have just created validate add user form module, and we also created a model module. Now it is a good time to add these components in our page and see how they are working. Am I able to enable and disable button or not? So once I updated the index.js file, which is at the root level, then it will be automatically added to the website. Since I am using a webpack, in the webpack I have said in the entry, go to the src client app and index.js file, which is this file index.js where we have exported all of our modules. Therefore, webpack will go ahead and take all of the components and bundle them up in the single file called as bundle.js, and it will put that bundle.js in our website. Therefore, you do not need to worry importing one by one everybody as a script in your page. So it is free for you. Therefore, I am using Node.js and Webpack so that it is very easy for us for our development. So now let's go ahead and type npm run serve. This way it will run a in-memory server for us and it will serve our page. So as you can see here, our page is coming up here, and by default the submit button is disabled. Now let me type out the correct name but wrong email ID, and let's see if the submit button is enabling or not. So if I put correct name and I put an invalid email ID, so this is the invalid email ID because it has the @ symbol but it does not have a dot symbol yet. The moment I will put a dot symbol, email ID will become valid and our entire form will become valid and our submit button will become enabled. Let me show you. So see, the moment I put .com, our submit button is now enabled. That means our code is working and we have successfully done the validation. Now it is a good time to go ahead and show the invalid messages in the top of the form. So let's do that next.